Does a wider tire give you more grip? 285, 255, 225. We're gonna go testing and find out. To find out, I've come back to Goodyear's incredible test facility at Miraval in the south of France, and I've got these three different tire sizes. I've got a 225 40 19, a 255 35 19, and a massive 285 30 19. Now, we're using a BMW 3 Series, which comes from factory with staggered tire fitment. So we've got three tires, but we've got five combinations of tires to test. We're gonna start with the stock OE size, which is a 225 40 front and a 255 35 rear. This is gonna be the kind of benchmark we use to judge how the others have performed. The next key one that I'm really interested in doing is the upsize front and rear. So that would be the 255 35 front and then the 285 30 rear. This will give us the indication, or the biggest indication, of whether just adding width really helps, because it should, in theory, keep the balance of the car the same. The other test we're gonna do, just for interest, I'm gonna do a 255 square. So the same tire front and rear, 255 35 19. We're gonna do a 225 square as well. So the little one, front and rear. And then just to see how much understeer we can put into a car, we're gonna do a 225 front and the massive 285 rear. So that's the five different combinations of tires we'll be using. Once again, we're using the Goodyear Eagle F1 Asymmetric 3. It's a tire I just really enjoy using because it doesn't overheat particularly quickly on the hot laps. It performs really well in the wet. It holds its balance with all the cars we've tested it on. And it's just a lovely tire. So very happy to be using this tire again. The astute of you will be saying, well, you're putting a wider tire on, more width equals more contact area, so we're gonna get more grip. As with tires, nothing is really that simple. While we are widening the contact area, we're actually making it shorter. So the wider the tire gets, the shorter it is. And I should be overlaying some lovely pictures of exactly this. It gets even more complicated when you start looking at dynamic load with cambers, weight in the car, cornering. So it's not to say that a wider tire necessarily gives you more contact area. The test we'll be running with these five sets of tires are the usual array of dry, wear, aquaplaning testing. So anything I don't cover in the video will be covered on the Tyre Reviews website in the full article. For now, let's get testing. First up, we're gonna start with dry handling, and we're gonna start with the stock sizes and then progressively get wider and sillier and just see what happens. First up, dry handling tests. Now, I'm gonna reference everything back to the stock setup for this BMW, which is the 225 front and the 255 rear. And on those tires, the car had quite a nice balance with a hint of understeer. You never really had to worry about the back, but that might be something to do with the lack of power this 320 has. But the car, in the high speed stuff, it just pushed a little bit. It wasn't too much, was manageable, and felt nice. Upsizing to the 255 and the 285 front and rear, didn't really change the balance as you would expect, because we've gone up the same measurement front and rear. What it did bring was a bit of a different front end, because you're now turning in with a 255 front instead of the narrower 225 front. The way that manifested was the 255 felt a little bit slower to turn initially, but once the tire started loading up, it was happier to turn mid-corner and felt like it offered more grip. It also gave you more confidence when you were pushing into the corners, like trailing the brakes. Again, with the 285 rear, I mean, with this car, we're not gonna really trouble the rear for oversteer moments. So it was felt as stable as it did before. And like I said, the balance was matching it with understeer. It was faster, and over a 137 lap, it was 1.2 seconds faster than the stock setup. So the wider tire has offered more grip in the dry. Moving from the 255 front and the 285 rear to the 255 all round was actually really interesting. The balance changed from a little bit of understeer neutral to a little bit of oversteer neutral, which allowed me to have a little bit more fun driving the car. Interestingly, the actual lap times didn't change between the 255 and 285 and the 255 square. That might be because, or it probably is because, this car isn't the most powerful car in the world, and the added little bit of oversteer just gave me a little bit more confidence to carry a bit more speed through the corners without having to worry about lifting for understeer. Moving to the 225 square setup, which is the narrower tire front and back, again, the balance was similar, more a hint of oversteer than the 255 square, but you had less confidence. The tires gave up grip a little bit sooner. You just felt a little bit slower everywhere, and you were about a second slower than, or second and a half slower than the 255 square. And lastly, the 225 front and 285 rear setup was horrible. The car just, as you would expect, understeered everywhere. You had no real control over the back end. It just felt like a bit of a dog, to be honest. So of the five setups tested, I would say stick with the stock or stick with the slightly upsized 255, 285, because that's probably what's safest on the road. In a more powerful car, the 255, 285 will give you a much bigger advantage because you'll be able to put down more power coming out of the corner. Like, this is flat out in this thing and it's just not really going anywhere. But it is super interesting to see how on the front axle, the wider tire did offer more grip compared to the 255 square and the 225 square, so the smaller and medium square setup all round. You could really notice the extra grip the wider tire gave you in the drive. One other thing worth mentioning is tire overheating. If you're doing a lot of track days, as you know, especially on road tires, the tires overheating is a concern. And one thing I noticed with the 225 front is it held on a little bit longer than the 225 front without really causing you an issue. So that's one other advantage that you might not have instantly thought about, that the 255 front or the wider front handles the heat a little bit better. So now we've seen the differences in the dry, I'm going to go over to wet handling and see where the differences are in the wet, because I think they'll be very different. Wet handling was kind of reversed compared to dry handling. In the dry, where the wider tire was actually an advantage, in the wet, the 285 was pretty horrible and the narrow tires performed better. So with the BMW stock setup, the 225, 255, the car was fairly well balanced with a little bit of oversteer. Nice turning and just was very drivable. Switching to the 255 square and the 225 square, you didn't really lose any time. They were all roughly the same time. What did change was the balance of the car, and that was going from a understeery car to a more balanced slash oversteery car. And again, the difference between the 225 and the 255 square setup was all about the steering feel and how it turned in. The 225 turned in more quickly, but then kind of gave up grip as you were turning, whereas the 255 felt a little bit soft as you turned in compared to the 225. But once you were in the corner, it was nice and you could change the direction of steering and the car just felt a lot more trusting. And both with the both square setups, the balance of the car was, it was neutral with a hint of oversteer, but it certainly wasn't dangerous. Going with the 255, 285 and the 225, 285, so the both the two different fronts and the wider rear, the 285 just was twitchy and snappy, so you couldn't really lean on the car like you could with any of the other setups. What you found, you were just driving around the corners waiting to be able to use the throttle and waiting for the car to kick, so you lost quite a bit of time. And both combinations of setup with the 285 rear were about 1.5 seconds slower over this lap, and it's a shorter lap, so that's about 6%, so that's quite a lot of time to give up over a short lap. The aquaplaning results give us a hint as to why the 285 was a lot more difficult to manage on this wet handling circuit. The 225 was the best, the 255 was about 6% worse, so the tyre started floating 6% earlier than the 225, and the 285 was over 15% worse than the 225, so it's quite a big difference in aquaplaning tests, which is no big surprise. The wider tyre, even with the shorter footprint, still has a lot more distance to move the water out the sides. So we've had the wider tyre quicker in dry handling, we've had the narrower tyres a little bit quicker in wet handling. Let's move on to braking and see what changes there. Braking. It's a boring test to do, but it's a test you have to do. And over a couple of hundred braking runs, we found out exactly what we probably already knew. For braking, the wider the tyre, the better. Now, there was only about 2% covering the worst to the best on test, with the 255, 285 being the best, and the 255 square pretty much matching. So, as you probably know, a lot of braking comes down to the front axle, which is why the change of the size on the rear axle didn't make a huge amount of difference. One thing that was more interesting noting on dry handling is the braking into corners was a lot more confidence inspiring on the 255 front. So on the 225 you could probably brake as late, but as you started to turn in and brake, like I'm about to, on the 255 front you just had a lot more control of the car and you could trail the brakes in a little bit longer, which was a nice upside of the wider tire. So what can I conclude from this test? Does wider tires give you more grip? Well, certainly does in the dry. The 255 and the 285 had an advantage over the 225 and 255. It gave you more grip on turning. You did change the car's subjective feeling, and the steering between the 225 and the 255 was a little bit different, but overall, the faster combination was the wider tires. The difference should have been bigger had I been using a car with a little bit more power. And I think I'm gonna have to rerun this test in the future with something with a bit more meat, because there was no point I was really overcoming the 255 rear, let alone the 285 rear. So a car maybe like an M4 would post a much faster time on the wider tire. Should you now think about widening your tires for road performance? I don't think there's enough in it, unless you've got a lot of power, to really worry about fitting wider tires. We're talking about like 2% across the three tires, and that's not a huge amount. What's more important is how the car's balanced dynamically, and switching between the 255 squares or the 225 squares and the 225, 285, just bolting a massive tire to the rear doesn't really give you a huge increase in performance. And what it does do is it upsets the balance of the car, gives you a lot more understeer. So you've got to be mindful when you're moving your tire width sizes, not only to tell your insurance company, but also to be thinking about the overall balance of the car and what you actually want from the car. Because like in the case of this lower power 320, I enjoyed the square setups because it just gave me a little bit more movement at the rear. But I can see why BMW have gone with the staggered setup for general road driving. As always, there's probably a bigger difference between fitting a really good set of tires like these Goodyear Eagle F1 asymmetric threes and a set of cheap tires. So maybe concentrate less on the width unless you're changing wheel size, and do your research. Check out sites like Tyre Reviews for the kind of information you need about picking the right tire for your vehicle and the one that suits your driving style the most. If you've enjoyed this video, please feel free to give it a thumbs up and subscribe. Every little bit helps me. If you want any further information, there'll be a link in the description linking you to the Tyre Reviews website with all the cool technical information regarding wheel weights, offsets, cambers, the different wheel sizes we had to use to make this possible. Once again, a huge thank you to Goodyear. Without them, this test wouldn't have been possible. They've supported us with the race track, they've supported us with all the tires, the cars, working out all the different variables we need to make the three different sizes fit a standard car. It's not been an easy test. It's taken about a year of planning. So a huge thank you to Goodyear again. Be sure to like and subscribe. Plenty more videos to come. Thanks again for watching. Questions below. Happy motoring.